Well, good afternoon, everybody. How is everybody today?
Great.
Really good. Okay, I'm going to bring you down a little bit. We're going to talk a little bit of murder and mayhem after lunch, which is nice. I think it's very, very, very easy to digest your lukewarm chicken or whatever it was over at the LVCC. My name is Paul Kahn. I'm on the faculty here. I'm a professor of national security studies, part of the Department of National Security and Strategy. I've been here since 2005. We had some early technical glitches, but I think we're going to sort them out. Hopefully this thing works. If not, Bill, you're up, buddy. Bill's going to help me out. For the new members, welcome. I'm sure you've been welcomed a whole bunch of times over the past couple of days. I'm actually a proud member of my home seminar number two. I got two people here from two. And I was also part of seminar one. There's no one. Oh, the visa's right here. All right. Sorry, there's one from one, so it all makes sense today. At any rate, yeah, it's been a very busy academic year for us. We've changed a lot of our curriculum, a lot of our faculty running around trying to get our heads on straight. It's the week before graduation. Students had their final electives. They had their strategy research paper. So it's been a hectic time for faculty. There's actually a yearbook photo of me. It's ready to go. And of course, that's not me. That's Nick Nolte, who's had, shall we say, his own issues with substance abuse and drugs, et cetera. So perhaps we'll talk a little bit about Hollywood towards the end with Q&A. Most of what you're going to hear today is taken from my book. My latest book is Cartels at War, published by Potomac Books a couple of years ago. For those of you who are interested in picking up a copy, you should note that I don't make any royalties. All my royalties are donated to the National Military Family Association. So if you happen to pick up a copy, please know that some of your money goes to a good cause other than my publisher. I do the same thing with my first book, which is Drugs and Contemporary Warfare, which is kind of a springboard for my second book. And the reason I mentioned this book is I kind of looked up its Amazon ranking yesterday, and it needs a little bit of help. It's in the top 2 millionth, which is good. So it's selling like whatever the opposite of hotcakes is, which is a shame because it got some good reviews. My students in my elective, one of them said that he found it particularly useful, and kind of not sure how I feel about that, but you know, hey, students are being what they are. Today, the presentation is rated PG-13. There's some strong language, some very strong images, and it's not just for shock value, but it's to try to portray an accurate representation of what is happening in certain parts of Mexico in particular. I know the title is Transnational Crime in the Americas, but we're actually seeing a lot of activity kind of converging on Mexico, unfortunately, and spreading outwards as well, coming up through Central America, and we'll go through a little bit of that as time marches on. What I'd like to start with is the story of a town called El Porvenir. El Porvenir is a small Mexican town. It's right here by the A, down here. In April 2011, 30 Mexican families picked up all their belongings and walked the 864 yards to the U.S.-Mexico border, which is here. They crossed it and went to another small farming town, this one in Texas, called Fort Hancock. You can see it just up there by the 20. When they were there, they asked for asylum. And the reason they asked for asylum is because 3 days before they left El Porvenir, a drug gang hung a banner in the center of their town saying unless you paid 300 pesos per child, they couldn't guarantee that child's safety. And in what might be a rather ominous sign, El Porvenir is Spanish for the future. And with many scenes like this occurring in parts of Mexico, you can understand why the residents of El Porvenir were frightened. Since 2006, over 70,000 Mexicans have been victims of drug-fueled violence. By 2008, there were more beheadings in Mexico than there were in Iraq and Afghanistan combined. And out of those two countries, from those war zones, Iraq and Afghanistan, more Americans have actually died in Mexico than any other country. So what I'd like to talk to you today about are these five questions. How are drugs trafficked through Mexico? Why is drug trafficking in particular so violent? What are the effects here in the United States on the homeland? Could the situation get worse? What might be some signs for that? And then a lot of people are talking about border security. The problem is border security, or the answer is border security. So what I've done is I've actually put together a type of photographic essay of my field research along the US-Mexico border to give us an idea of what are we really talking about when we talk about border security, when we talk about strengthening our fence or our borders. So first of all, a very basic primer on what a drug trafficking network looks like. If it's a botanical drug, something like marijuana, heroin, or cocaine, you have to have a drug crop of some kind. It has to be grown. If it's methamphetamine, methamphetamine is a synthetic drug, it's produced. So for those of you who are fans of Breaking Bad, you can sort of know what I'm talking about. But from the growth of the particular drug crop, it has to be processed some way. So there are precursor chemicals in the case of heroin and cocaine to turn it into that finished product. Then it goes on to what we call the wholesale market, where it's bulk shipped oftentimes or aggregated into bigger shipments, and then disaggregated to be smuggled across a border for retail sales, what we would call street sales. And along the way, there's profit taking, and it has to be deposited somewhere in the legal economy. Somewhere along these stages, dirty money will touch clean money. It will be laundered somehow. Some investments will be made by the drug traffickers, and it has to be transported along the way. So if you were to blow this up and place this very basic template on our hemisphere, you would see where Mexico becomes a very important drug node. It's really a hybrid node. I understand this is rather busy and involved. It kind of looks like an acid trip all on its own. But what you should see here are, again, a lot of the drugs going up to the border states in Mexico, border cities, the wholesale markets, and a lot of the precursor chemicals coming from Asia to help process things. And a lot of Andean cocaine and Andean heroin transiting overland or through sea via Mexico onto the US and now also into West Africa. So Mexico is a rather complex situation. It's a hybrid node in hemispheric drug trafficking. So it's a source country for American marijuana and for some heroin and also for methamphetamine. It's also a transit country for Andean cocaine and some heroin, but it's also a small growing retail market where consumption is happening, especially around tourist cities, of things like marijuana, methamphetamine, and cocaine. So it becomes difficult to try to disaggregate and figure out a proper strategy. Should you treat Mexico as a source country, as a transit country, or as a demand country, when in fact it's all three of these put together? And it's a very profitable and lucrative industry. The estimates are that it's somewhere between $18 and $39 billion annually. So if you compare this to legitimate parts of the Mexican economy, there really is no comparison. So Mexican remittances from Mexicans living in the United States sent back to Mexico are on the lower end of that scale of about $18 billion. It vastly outstrips the Mexican tourist economy, which is about $11 to $13 billion. And by point of comparison to a US industry or company, JP Morgan Chase's profits from last year total about $18 billion. So a little bit lower on the scale. So in fact, there's a lot of money to profit over.
Tourism revenue, current or
current.
Several years ago?
Current.
Current.
Yep, as of last year. Yep. So violent have things become in Mexico that they've had to develop a new lexicon in journalism to describe how bodies are displayed. So here are a few of the examples. One of my favorites is pozoleado, or turning somebody's body into stew or soup. There was actually a man named El Pozolero, who was part of the Tijuana cartel, El Pozolero, the soup maker, who was accused of actually dissolving about 300 people in vats of acid over time. Now, each of these particularly gruesome deaths comes with a message. They're not just random acts. They're not just gruesome for gruesome sake. But in fact, there is a message attached to these particular corpses. We call it corpse messaging. So if you're shot in the forehead, it's disrespect. If you're shot in the back of the head, it's betrayal. If you have your hands cut off, you somehow stole from the group. If you dismembered somebody, it's rivalry with another cartel or another gang. If you dismembered the hands and stuck them in the mouth, the victim has somehow provided information to the police. But why has it become so violent? Well, really, organized criminal syndicates and gangs will use violence, big strategic level violence, for five big reasons. There are kind of micro-social reasons as well. You know, hey, he disrespected me, or he looked at my girlfriend the wrong way. What we're talking about, strategic calculations of the use of violence for dismembering a person. So one of the big ones is the enforcement of a contract or an agreement in an illegal environment, in an uncertain and murky world, which is criminal activity. In the licit world, if there's some sort of disagreement over a contract, well, we can go to court. But let's say Bill and I have an agreement over a shipment of cocaine, that it's going to be a kilo, and we'll price it at, say, $10,000. We'll price it on the low end. Well, there can be any source of disagreement between the two of us. There could be a disagreement over purity. It could be a disagreement over what time that product is going to be shipped and where. It could be a disagreement over price. Well, if there is a disagreement, he and I can't exactly go to court. We can't go, Your Honor, you know, here's the deal. We had an agreement over a shipment of cocaine, and he sort of backed out on it. No, the courts frown on that. So in the legal world, when there is a disagreement between two individuals, those people are called litigants. In the illegal world, if there's a disagreement, those people are called victims. There's also reasons for internal security. Yeah, if we're a group of cartel members, we're never really sure if we can trust everybody. It's called the villain's paradox. How can you trust somebody in an inherently untrustworthy environment? So it may be where Bill is, he's a little slow on the job, he's not bringing in quite as much money as he used to. You know, maybe he's working for somebody else. Maybe he's working for a rival. Boy, he better not be talking to the authorities. Well, we better find out. So we might send Moose and Rocco over to visit him and give him a couple of good shots to make sure to tell us what he knows and what he's doing. He may or may not be doing it, but now we've got another problem. The problem is Bill no longer trusts us. He might be thinking very reasonably, oh my God, you know, I put in some of the best years of my life with that group, and yeah, I'm a little slow this month, but they didn't have to beat me up. I mean, I've been a loyal member. So now we might have a real problem, because Bill might in fact decide to go work for our competition or to rat us out. And then we've got to do what's called the terminal sanction. We've got to send Moose and Rocco over to get rid of him, to kill him. And they'll kill him, and the last words he'll hear would be something to the effect of, hey, Bill, man, it's nothing personal. It's just
business.
It's just business, and we'll mean it. Also for competition. Yeah, thanks for the sound effects. That's excellent. I'll point to you for sound effects. For competition, we might actually use violence against rivals, or they may use violence against us to try to capture market share, to try to capture access to one of the routes to a northern Mexican city or to capture that Mexican city. A lot of infighting is happening that way as well. There are issues of succession within our own gang or cartel. Let's say Bill is the godfather and the leader of our group, and somehow he gets picked up. He gets picked up by the cops, he gets taken out by a rival. Well, who's gonna take over? Well, he may have made an agreement with Marcos. He said, look, man, you are the man. If something happens to me, you're in charge of the group. However, he may have made a side deal with me and said, hey, I you know what I told Marcos? I told him I was gonna let him take over, but I just needed his vote on something. He was gonna hook me up with another connection. But really, Paul, you're the man. So if Bill's taken out of the equation, again, they're villain's paradox. How can we trust? I'd say, Marcos, this is what happened. He said, no, that probably didn't happen. So now there's a disagreement within the group, a split, factions begin to form behind each one of us, and another group may see that we're the weaker group now. We're divided, and they can try to pinch market share or pinch a couple of our members, poach them, and take them away into their group. So that's the problem. Another issue is prestige or reputation. Honestly, don't we want to be the biggest, baddest gang in town so nobody will mess with us? Can serve as a deterrent. So you're going to cut the heads off my guys, six of my guys? I'll tell you what we're going to do. We're going to cut the face off you, stitch it to a soccer ball, and leave it in a cooler at a national football stadium, which happened in Mexico. And this has actually become much more complicated by the sheer number of cartels, drug trafficking organizations that are operating in Mexico. So far, the situation kind of stabilized. You've got about seven or eight of them. I'm not going to go through all eight of them, but just kind of highlight a couple. The Sinaloa cartel was run by El Chapo Guzman, Joaquin El Chapo Guzman. They picked him up just earlier this year. In fact, he was sunning himself in Mazatlan with his wife. His twin daughters were there, picked him up in the condo. He was voted by Forbes magazine as one of the wealthiest individuals on earth. But the Mexican Marines got him. There is La Familia and Los Caballeros Templarios. Los Caballeros Templarios is basically the Knights Templar. they have a rivalry, they split off from each other. What's kind of interesting about this group is they're not just drug traffickers, they're kind of this quasi-mystical, robust, born-again Christian cartel that will try to recruit some folks out of drug treatment centers with the leader's own version of the Bible. And if they don't come along and join, they'll basically spray the entire drug treatment facility with machine gun fire and get rid of them. So that's a very peculiar one. And also the head of La Familia, we thought he was killed in 2010. We were assured he was killed in 2010. And we just killed him again in January. So he's dead, deader. Or as kids say, for realsy this time. For realsy, we got him. Losetas, or the Z's, the letter Z, were members of the Mexican Special Forces who worked and defected and deserted and began to work for the Gulf Cartel. They broke away from the Gulf Cartel, started their own thing. They're particularly adept at information operations because they're counterinsurgents. So they're also very violent. They like to carve the letter Z into people's flesh. We'll talk a little bit more about them in a little bit. But not just these major cartels are a problem. Again, if you think about the five big strategic issues related to working in an uncertain environment, if you have that number of folks, the level of trust goes down. But there's also a number of street gangs and enforcer groups that work with these folks. There are over two dozen of them that we can identify that often work across the border here in the United States. Sometimes they work together, sometimes they fall out, sometimes there's a balance of power, sometimes they work together on one issue but not another issue, one transaction but not another transaction. So it gets pretty complicated.
But do they tend to be farm teams for the main ones, or are they separated?
Sometimes they're farm teams, sometimes they're separate, just depends on, oftentimes depends on the day. Or whether or not, hey, you looked at my girlfriend wrong. So you've got the micro-social level issues that go along with the use of violence. Some of the tactics that these cartels use really resemble insurgent tactics that you'll see in internal struggles or civil wars or guerrilla movements. This is what's called a narco-bloqueo, which is a narco-blockade or a blockade of drug dealers, where they will actually, for example, carjack a truck or a bus and place it across a road, sometimes setting it on fire, to prevent the authorities from getting to the scene of the crime where they're actually going after competition or attacking a police station. Another form of narco-bloqueo is they'll simply take a truck full of corpses, 30 corpses, dump them on the freeway during rush hour. This happened just outside of, I think, Mazatlan. And so all the attention is diverted to these bodies. Meanwhile, they're committing their atrocities somewhere else in the city. What's particularly troubling is, I mentioned Los Zetas and information warfare. They're getting particularly adept at finding anonymous people on the internet and killing them. So bloggers or people who even post on a blog, they'll find and hunt them down. So here are a couple of examples. 2011, two corpses were hung off a bridge in Nuevo Laredo with the sign, "This will happen to you, internet busybodies. Shape the, well, blank up. I am on to you." Later that month, a blogger, her name was Laredo Girl, decapitated, hands cut off, placed in the center of town by a fountain, by a roundabout, traffic roundabout, two computer keyboards by her hands, with the note, "I'm here because of my reports," four Z's carved into her flesh. Two Mexican college kids up in the Northeast were threatened, "Take down your blog or else," so they took it down. They had a cyber skirmish with the hacktivist group Anonymous. I actually wrote an article about this, where Anonymous was threatening to disclose all the members of Los Zetas, all the people they colluded with, quote, from taxicab drivers to politicians, unless they released one member of Anonymous that they had kidnapped. So this went back and forth for a little bit. I wrote an article about this, and it went online, and in the comments section, a member of Anonymous actually wrote in the comment section, "Hey, we've got a new operation going on in a different town. If you want more information, hit us up on Twitter." Okay. So then I wrote another article about that episode in that town, and it went online. And once again, the group, this new Anonymous group, posted in the comment section, "Yeah, you know, Khan's got it right." I'm like, okay. "And, you know, we're starting another operation. Follow us here on Twitter." I'm like, oh my God, I'm going to have to publish under a different name. I think I'm going to publish under Mike Phillips. I think that's a good name. See what happens to him. Test the water. Oh, man. I tell you what, there's also a narco culture that surrounds a lot of this in Mexico. So, for example, these are narcomantas or banners that people hang over bridges in very public spaces to declare certain things. So, for example, this one on the left is Soltitos de Plomo, so little soldiers of lead, so toy soldiers. And then Federales de Paja, and a little smiley face. Federales cops, but de paja is actually kind of slang. It means straw, but it literally means straw, but the closest equivalent would be wanker cops. So you wanker cops. This is the territory of Arturo Beltran Leyva. This one is in terrible Spanish, and it basically says, look, you're protecting all these leaders and the leaders of the political parties, but why aren't you protecting us? Why aren't you going after the right people? There's also narcocorridos, which is a style of music. So this is La Banda del Carro Rojo, Los Tigres del Norte. And it actually will celebrate the exploits of a lot of these traffickers, the real-life exploits of them. And in fact, you can commission a song about one of your fallen comrades to play at his funeral. And the more accurate it is, well, the more money you spend, but also the more popular it becomes. There's also narco saints. So there's Santa Muerte and Jesus Malverde. Santa Muerte is actually kind of a folklore type of deity that some of the narcos have kind of misappropriated for their own uses. And Jesus Malverde, you'll find his image in a lot of smuggling vehicles because he's used to give them protection, to prevent them from being apprehended or killed. But a lot of folks will venerate Santa Muerte for the same reasons. There's some issue of whether or not there's blood sacrifices to Santa Muerte, but I'm trying to confirm that. Jesus Malverde is actually found in so many different places. It's very widespread. So for example, if you want to get your nails did, you can get Santa Muerte, or sorry, Jesus Malverde on that one.
That was the same practice in Colombia and Medellin, when Pablo Escobar told people, that where the sicarios, they were going out before they were either killing or doing a transaction of drugs or actually sending drugs to the United States, mainly to Miami. They used to go there, Catholic Church, and pray to ensure that that shipment actually made it to the United States.
Thanks for that, because I want to mention these are not part of the pantheon of Catholic saints. These are sort of bootlegged. Again, Santa Marta is more folkloric. Jesus Malverde, the image is actually taken from a Mexican movie star from the 1940s. So again, not part of the established Catholic religion. And this may be something we'll have to get used to here in the United States, because according to the National Drug Intelligence Center, we're finding in 250 cities some connection to Mexican gangs or cartels. So, guess find your city on here. In fact, here in Pennsylvania, just over the weekend, they got Salvador El Viejo Limas. El Viejo, the old one or the old man, he was a farmer down in Chester County. He was there for 20 years. Well, he was working for La Familia, and he's responsible for $60 million worth of cocaine transiting through our fair state. There's a 600 count indictment against him, and he's caught actually on a recording device saying, hey, look, man, I've had the same phone for 20 years. They're not gonna find me. Awesome. So we nabbed that guy. So one of the things I think we're most concerned about, of course, is spillover crime here in the United States. What are the effects here? Well, home invasions in Phoenix rose. They surged to about one a day in 2008, because a lot of folks are just being taken out of their homes, thrown in a trunk, driven down to Mexico, and clipped in Mexico. Because you don't want to kill anybody in the U.S. You want to do all your killing down in Mexico if you have to. A U.S. soldier was arrested in connection for being part of a cartel. He was a hitman. He clipped a federal witness, I think, out in Dallas. There's another Marine who's on the payroll in Mexico right now. They got him. There are lake pirates in Texas. There's a Falcon Lake where the border actually straddles the lake. So a lot of Los Zetas will actually shake down tourists who are on jet skis or boats for money, try to get them involved in smuggling drugs across the border. So these are actually sort of pirates. And so far, in talking with some of my colleagues and peers, we found six confirmed drug cartel-related beheadings in the United States. We found more, but we're not really, really sure if they're connected. We found one where, well, they didn't have their heads all the way off their bodies. And this was up in I think this is Birmingham or Atlanta, where there are three of them, and it's a lot of work, man. Your arms get tired, so they just didn't get them quite off. Let's just put it that way. There's also this issue of who I call narco refugees. These are Mexicans, like those in El Porvenir, who are coming to the United States seeking asylum. They're not what we would call illegal immigrants who are coming across for economic opportunities, but they're afraid to go back home. And you can see the numbers are steadily rising. And these are people like journalists, police officers, those who are related to journalists and police officers. What's stunning is in the 1990s, no Mexican came here asking for asylum. And the numbers, they might be larger. We're just not sure. You probably have a lot of folks who've moved around different cities in Mexico. But another interesting statistic is the number of traditional illegal immigrants is going down, but these numbers are up. So we have a category of folks that's actually increasing coming from the Mexican side. So how will we know if it's getting really bad in Mexico, where we'd have to kind of readjust our policy and our strategy a little bit more? Jaws was on. The movie Jaws was on over the weekend, and if you remember when the shark first makes his appearance, right? You know, Roy Scheider is chumming, and all of a sudden the shark is there, and he kind of stumbles backwards, and his words are, "Ooh, we're going to need a bigger boat." Yeah, if this starts happening, we're going to need a bigger policy. We're going to need a bigger boat. So, for example, if there are cross-border vigilante raids going back into Mexico, where the U.S. becomes safe haven, where they arm themselves, go back in, and start clearing out towns, and coming back up to the United States for safety. So we begin to look like Waziristan in Pakistan. If members of the Mexican military start coming to the United States seeking asylum, that would be a bad sign. So far, that has not happened. Nobody from the Mexican military has done that. That would be a bad sign because if you think about it, the most coercive arm of the Mexican state would somehow believe that they're in jeopardy, they're in danger, they can't protect themselves, that they're losing the war. A Mexican Marine who clipped Arturo Beltran Leyva, he was killed in that firefight, celebrated him on Mexican TV, while the cartel found his family and killed the family. So, as a message. But again, no Mexican military members come to the U.S. seeking asylum. If the Mexican economy plummets, where foreign direct investment begins to pull out because it's just not safe. It's not safe for them, not safe for their personnel. Yeah, not happening so far. The Mexican economy is actually doing quite well. If there's an increasing brain drain of educated, experienced Mexicans leaving for other countries, not just the United States, but for, say, Spain, Europe, and other places, that would be a bad sign. And if the capital city becomes a zone of insecurity, where you're beginning to see the same things like beheadings, body dumps, corpse messaging, that would be a troubling sign. This has not happened in large measure in Mexico City. That would be bad because, again, the capital city is there to do the nation's business, to conduct policy. If it doesn't look like the nation can do that, then the other portions of the country begin to think, well, we've got to take care of ourselves. So with respect to the first part, cross-border vigilante raids, there is growing vigilanteism, vigilante groups, self-defense groups in Mexico, particularly in Michoacán and Guerrero. This is an example taken from earlier this year of vigilante groups that are going after the Knights Templar, Los Caballeros Templarios. Again, a worrying sign because we know from experience that a lot of these vigilante groups end up going into the same business they're trying to counteract. For example, we think La Familia Michoacana actually began as a vigilante movement and morphed into this crazy thing. So this is not a particularly healthy sign. So as I promised, border security. What do we mean by border security? Now, a lot of these photos I took myself when I went on my my field research. Some photos were sent to me afterwards by folks in Border Patrol or FBI or Immigration and Customs Enforcement, even National Park Service, and they said, "Paul, man, you missed it. Here's a photo." So I started my journey on the most western part of our border with Mexico, over in San Ysidro, San Diego, and Tijuana. You can see the border actually goes all the way into the Pacific Ocean. This is the fence. This is the old fence. You can see a little pylon right there, but the currents kind of washed it away. So moving up from the beach, this is actually, I think, the image we have in mind of what effective border security should look like. It's like, oh, okay, that's a good border. You've got pretty good fencing, concertina wire, you know, caution, aviso, be careful. You've got sensors, cameras, paved road for easy access. You know, the actual Mexican border is right here. So this is actually all American territory. Well, it's about 10 o'clock at night, and I'm with one of the Border Patrol supervisors. We're at a port of entry at San Diego, and he gets a call on his radio. Hey, we've got a swimmer. I'm like, what? A swimmer? What's that? Well, it was an American trying to come around that portion of the fence on a surfboard, coming from the Mexican side into the US side, and he had 10 pounds of waterproof pot on him. He probably had more, but he had to cut it loose because he was having trouble getting in with the currents and everything. Here it is on the evidence table, all wrapped. That's his little surf bag right there. So you can still get around that fence. So I moved on to Arizona. This is a sign in one of our national parks out by Nogales, kind of Douglas, Bisbee area, south of Tucson, if you will. But here you go. Smuggling and or illegal entry is common in this area due to the proximity of the international border. Please be aware of your surroundings at all times and do not travel alone in remote areas. And enjoy your picnic. So again. But the border does get a little more kind of ramshackle. That sign is way over my right shoulder, a few miles away. That's me. And I have been working out. Thanks for... Nobody said it. So that's me. Give you an idea of the aspect. But here is a dirt road, a gravel road. Well, 10 days after this was taken and 10 miles away, a Border Patrol agent was shot and killed. His name was Brian Terry. For those of you familiar with the Operation Fast and Furious, that there's a connection there. But he came upon with his fellow patrolmen, his fellow Border Patrol folks, a rip crew. A rip crew is a group of folks that hang out in a national park waiting for immigrants or drug smugglers to come by so that they can rip them off. So again, no honor amongst thieves. It's the villain's paradox. But a shootout occurred, and unfortunately, he lost his life. Again, it gets more and more ramshackle. Again, this is just kind of a cattle fence. Okay, and then you have private land you have to deal with. And a lot of folks get really frustrated with private land in the border. And this is a railroad tie from 1915 that a National Guardsman helped put up. And this is just a tire iron in sort of an ultimate gesture of futility of what's going on down there. So again, even if you have sophisticated parts of the fence down in that area, people are still going to try to get over it. So that's on the Mexican side. This is it, a little close up. That's a pickup truck with a ramp on it. So apparently they were going to drive an ATV over that, like Evel Knievel was going to smuggle some drugs or people into that. But you can tell they caught him kind of in flagrante delicto, where the doors are wide open and all of it. And, you know, really only a group of guys could come up with that idea. You know, I mean, not to sound sexist, but it's like, you know, I got this, here's a thought. What if you put a ramp on a pickup truck? And it all comes together when somebody said, you know, my uncle has a truck. And there you go. But then it doesn't have to be all that sophisticated. This is, on the Mexican side, a catapult. Yeah, this is. These are bales of marijuana, so it's a potapult. All you do is you sort of launch it across the fence, over the fence, and there's a waiting truck, and folks kind of, you know, take it away. So that's very basic, very medieval, as it were. So we've seen that you can get around the fence, you can get over the fence, which must mean you can probably go under it. So yeah, absolutely. This, for example, is Nogales. Nogales is actually one town divided by the border. Border just fell right on this particular town. So this is the border. This is the USA side, Nogales, Arizona, and Nogales, Sonora, over here. And people cross the border routinely day to day to do ordinary business, go in through here, come out over here, go for lunch. I did it, very easy. Take your border crossing documents, the whole thing. But what they did find is underneath and next to a parking meter in downtown, the entrance to a very small tunnel. So, well, that's interesting. What happens there? Well, you drive a vehicle over it with a false bottom, and like this, all the drugs come up, and all the guns and money go down. So, again, very unsophisticated. Some of the tunnels are miles long and have air conditioning and trains and, you know, a little Starbucks kiosk in there, you know, if you get tired. Oh, here you go. So, but of course, we all get sort of really wrapped around the security part of the border. And I think we have to be careful. There is sort of just daily living along the border that occurs without criminality. For example, this is a volleyball game. And the net is the border. And, you know, side out is going to happen, and you go through the Tecate tent for your immigration, and that ball is going to be served right into the United States at any minute. So again, I think we have to be sort of cautious when we think about security, the hard security part. So concluding reflections, what is Mexico doing right? I think that's important. You know, the country is embarking on some very ambitious reforms, especially trying to tackle corruption, and corruption in the judiciary and in law enforcement. They're actually transitioning from the inquisitorial system of justice to the adversarial system of justice, where corruption has a harder time taking hold in that particular system. And we're assisting and helping to train lawyers and judges to adopt that new system. If you think about it, that's really ambitious, to change your entire country's system of justice. Imagine if we in the United States decided to go the other way and change our system towards the inquisitorial system. That'd be really difficult. They are trying to focus on a coordinated strategy. There are a bunch of different strategies out there. The Attorney General has one strategy. National Security Department has one. The Secretary of the Navy has another one. So they're trying to get those together. There is a recognition that, look, using the military is not going to be the end-all be-all. Having 50,000 troops deployed on the streets is going to be, you know, unsustainable. And it's not the military's job to do police work. And they're seeking expertise from the outside, from Colombia, from Spain, from Canada, from the United States, to help with these reforms. So what does the U.S. need to do to support? Well, I think we need to continue to be respectful, especially of Mexican history and traditions, that there is some sensitivity when it comes to our own histories, our intertwined histories, and that the border is really the nexus of our communities. It's the nexus of public safety and security, but it's also the nexus of tradition and culture that we have to be mindful of. And I think we also have to be honest with ourselves and try to tackle drug demand. And we can probably talk about that during the Q&A. I always like to end with this. I was born in Hong Kong. My father is Hong Kong Chinese. My mother is Irish Scottish from Australia. And so for those of you who know Hong Kong history, Hong Kong used to be British. And the reason it was British is because the British won it from the Chinese Empire during the Opium Wars, where the British were trying to insert opium into the Kingdom of China, and the Chinese Emperor was trying to resist that. This is the Commissioner Lin, who the Chinese Emperor sent to burn the chests of British opium. You can see that happening just over the left shoulder of Commissioner Lin there. And then this is a picture of Mexican military police burning bales of marijuana. So it looks somewhat familiar, if you will. So with that, I'll end, and I'll be happy to take your questions for the next few minutes. Sir?
So I live in Washington, where marijuana has just been legalized. Mm-hmm. My son lives in Colorado, where
so it's your fault.
Is not the government enforcing the federal laws. And one of the big reasons to legalize marijuana is because the U.S. is using the war on drugs. So what do you think about legal marijuana, and how is that going to impact the cartel?
I think it's going to have a very minor impact on the cartels. And even if we were to, say, federalize legal marijuana, we simply don't know how much money Mexican cartels, American gangs, Salvadoran gangs make from marijuana. One estimate is about 70% of their profits come from marijuana. But again, we don't know because we can't audit them. You know, we can't go, hey, El Chapo, can we see your books this year? Like, no. So that's an estimate. The other issue then becomes, well, what do you do about the other drugs? And then do you not force those folks who had an expertise in smuggling marijuana, don't they then just, okay, we're gonna smuggle cocaine, heroin, methamphetamine? And it's really the same route. So it's not so much the product as it is the logistics. And I think maybe that's where we need to refocus our mental framework, that that these groups are not so much drug trafficking organizations anymore. They're almost like a dirty Amazon.com, where if you think Amazon.com, you almost immediately think books. When in fact, no, we know that they sell everything, and their niche is really to provide you with that as best they can, whatever you want, to try to get it to you as quickly as possible from multiple different sources. So really, that's what these drug trafficking organizations have now become. They're like a dirty logistics organization. They can do drugs, they can do people, they can do fake consumer goods, they can do money, they can do gift cards. they can do weapons. What is it that you want? Smuggle across that border. The other part of that is, let's say, for example, legalization worked. And it did end up throwing a lot of well-armed young men out of work. That's a problem, because they only know one thing, which is la pistola. And we saw that with the end of the Soviet Union, that all of a sudden the Soviet Union goes away and you have a lot of well-armed men who are proficient in weapons, and they go into organized crime. KGB, Red Army, like, well, okay, you don't need me. Those guys do. They need me for security. I'll just do that. So there is a problem on all sides of that. That's not to say that we shouldn't discuss the legalization issue, but I think we need to be, we need to go into it with our eyes wider open than that. And so, sir, in the back.
When describing threats to the U.S., the dialogue about transnational criminal organizations is often very separate from the threats posed by the terrorist groups. Although there's some reporting indication that there's growing collaboration in money laundering and maybe, you know, human smuggling. What are your thoughts on whether or not those relationships between the terrorist groups and the TCOs are going to increase, or are they going to remain somewhat limited?
Yeah, you know, it depends on what it will be for. Right? There's always going to be kind of these tactical transactional relationships. Hey, you've got expertise in this. You've got expertise in that. Oh, you have access to this. You've got access to that. But there is, again, transnational criminal organizations are in the business of making money. And interfering with that business model is going to be a problem. So if you begin to do things that are a little bit harder on the security issue side of things, where you're getting really close to terrorism, especially against the U.S., then you're asking for a whole bunch of laws to be dropped on your head that you don't need to be really bothered with. Anti-drug laws are hard, you know, tough enough, but if you start to drop the USA Patriot Act stuff on their heads, they've got a big problem. So they try not to blur that distinction too much, because it's bad for that business model. On the political end, yeah, these guys will, again, tactical, they'll do what it takes to keep on living in a world where there's fewer and fewer state supporters of what they do. So yeah, they'll do more criminal activity. But then again, they've got a problem where they don't want to do too much criminal activity that takes away from their political message. Like, well, are we a political organization bent on la revolución, or are we just a bunch of gangsters? So I think we need to be more thoughtful about how that threat might happen. Like I said, yeah, there are blendings and blurrings, but is there a total merger? No, not at least not that I've seen. So, oh, sir.
Me?
Yes, oh, of course.
Okay. I've lived in Mexico for the past 8 years.
Mm-hmm.
Before that, I was a lawyer in California. I lived in the central part of Mexico, Guanajuato, which is in the center of Mexico. There's a large American community in San Miguel de in there. There must be 30,000 mm-hmm. Americans. In Guanajuato, there must be 3,000 to 5,000 of us living there. It's very curious because we get tired of this, mm-hmm. okay? Of people, the scare is incredible. We have a casita that we rent out mainly to Americans, and it's on our property, mm-hmm. and to Canadians. A Canadian came to us last year and he says, you know why? He says, I got an alert, a drug alert from the United States, and I got the same type of thing from Canada. I mean, I thought it was going to two different countries, depending on which one you wanted to believe.
Right.
There is a woman, a friend of mine, who comes from New Orleans, who said that she got so tired of them asking her, why do you live here? It's so unsafe. Why do you live there? And so unsafe there. And she finally turned and she said, you know, I'm from New Orleans. And last weekend they had 9 killings there. Okay. In terms of what you're putting out there now, do you think there's been a tremendous difference since the new president has come in?
I think, you know, we actually had this discussion amongst a few of us who studied this issue for quite a few years. And what has happened is there is now a different reporting system that the Mexican government is using to note a homicide. So the previous administration used to actually mark, okay, a homicide, there are three bodies discovered, that's three homicides. No. Now it's one open investigation involving three people. Wow. So that's a statistical manipulation. And the previous administration also did it as well. And we think there might actually be more than 70,000. But
well, this started, from what I can tell, it started with Bush and Calderon. They were going to put them into the trafficking from Mexico. That was in 2004 or 2005. Mm-hmm. And that's where your numbers come in.
Mm-hmm.
There's very little of what you present since the PRI came in.
Yeah, it's because they're shading the numbers. They're going back to their old ways.
Well, I was at a fundraising dinner with a deputy who was someone who works for the one of the senators before the election. Okay, came up and we were talking, and I said, "Well, what's going to happen now?" He said, "Well, the major problem is security in terms of Mexican people thinking, hey, this border thing's got to stop." And I said, "So, what's the PRI? What are they going to do about that?" He says, "Well, probably," he says, "they're going to get the cartel in, and they have meetings with them, okay? And they're going to tell them, here's your established route. We're not Bush and Calderon anymore. You're going to have your old roots.
Right.
We just don't want any more violence." And you talk about numbers, and I'm talking about as far as we can tell.
Mm-hmm.
That has gone down dramatically, okay? The next thing, the shorty who got picked up just, what, about 2 months ago or mm-hmm. 3 months ago?
Almost 3 months, yep.
Yeah. He wasn't sunning himself. He was actually in the condo
right.
on the sixth floor with his twin daughters and his
His
wife.
beauty queen. Right?
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, okay. So, he's ranked as one of the most brilliant, richest people according to Forbes. You know, the problem I have with this, and you're talking about $18 billion a year, and something that shakes my head. That's not street money that we're, you know, in New York City, they're giving it on the corner so they can bring it across. Major banking institutions in the United States are involved.
Oh, yeah. Oh, they've been fined.
The government has to know who they
fair enough.
Are, and they're turning their eyes on that.
Yeah.
And that, you know, that's not only sinful, you talk about. You know how many lives are being destroyed because of that?
No, I appreciate that. And actually, one thing we do know about tackling organized crime is hitting the personnel doesn't work as well as hitting their bank accounts. That's how you bring down a criminal organization. Sir, you've been very patient.
No, sir,
you've already gone on for 5 minutes. I'd like to have another question, if you don't mind. Share the stage.
I'm a lawyer in Minneapolis. I've volunteered to help a couple of folks do their Dream Act. I guess my question to you is, how does this border problem, the narco terrorism problem, how does that influence or inform the immigration debate? And can you separate those two issues? Because, you know, I represent people who are nice people. They're running from, you know, and contrary to what this gentleman was saying, they're telling me, my clients have told me, they're terrified to ever go back to Mexico.
Right. Yeah, I don't.
They come to Minneapolis, and that's saying something.
Yeah, for me, I don't think I, having grown up in Hawaii, you know, I don't think the immigration issue is really going to have much of an effect on the criminal issue, because you already have major cartel figures living in the United States, because it's actually safer. I mean, you don't want to, you know, as a cartel member, you don't want to live in Mexico. You're going to get killed. But here, you can take somewhat advantage of the larger umbrella of security here. And plus, you can get a B1, B2 visa, which is a tourist business visa that will last up to 6 months. So you can actually bed down in the United States, cross the border, go to work, and come back into the United States for the night. And a lot of people do that, you know, inversionistas, the inverted ones. And you have some mayors and some police chiefs will actually run their towns from the American side with a cell phone. So I don't think immigration reform is necessarily going to affect the criminal problem. I think that the criminal problem is going to affect the immigration problem.
Yes.
Or issue, I shouldn't even say problem. Tony. Oh, taking root in the same way. Yeah, that, say, Las Vegas. It's sort of a different subject. I mean, the history of, say, organized crime in America, with immigrant groups coming into the United States, Los Angeles just didn't have that same tradition. And also, the LAPD took a very different approach to various intrusions of organized crime into Los Angeles. Because by then, organized crime was recognized as organized crime. Beforehand, it was kind of the FBI wasn't really sure. What are we talking about? Organized? Okay, we have different groups doing different criminal acts. They seem to be part of a, you know, an ethnic group of some kind. So it took a while for that to be acknowledged and recognized. And by the time it was, Los Angeles, the LAPD already had a fairly effective strategy to deal with that. So, sir?
At one time, tourism was the number two industry in Mexico. How has this affected the tourism industry?
You know, I haven't seen any numbers that have dramatically affected the tourism industry. I'm not sure, Alejandro, if you've...
The last administration they make good efforts to maintain the touristic cities safely, and we maintain a good rate of international tourism on the main beaches, especially on these cities.
Right.
Obviously, what was affected.
Yeah. Got a time for a couple more questions. I want to make sure you get back to some. Sir?
I'm a little bit concerned about the commentary because what I have seen is more than 40 years, and it's a total failure of the strategy of the United States. The United States tried to put money to reduce demand and to reduce the offer, the supply. But it's like 30 to 70%, 55 to 65%. What is your opinion regarding the bottom line? The problem is a health problem, not the criminal problem.
Yeah, I think there's something to be said about that on the demand side, which is we can't criminalize users and use. That's shown to be ineffective. And then the public health issue is probably the right framework, but it's also very difficult to make that change, and also it's not going to be 100%. For example, public education. We all put our hopes in, okay, not just public schools, but okay, educating the public about how devastating the use of drugs would be. So you try to reduce consumption that way. Well, we've tried that before. Here's an example from our own history. This is the TV show Different Strokes. First Lady Nancy Reagan, Ronald Reagan's first lady. This is her campaign. And it was basically, look, if you kids are offered the opportunity to take drugs, you should just say no. And she unveiled this on a very popular national sitcom here in the United States called Different Strokes. You know, what you talk about, Willis. Well, the irony is that two of the child stars, Todd Bridges and Dana Plato, died of drug overdoses. And here's another one, smoking. This woman is very concerned about the noise that jackhammers have on her unborn child. Meanwhile, she's smoking for two. So all the health information about cigarettes, all the law, all the high taxation, some people are still not going to quite get the message. So, supply and demand, it's one big, it's trying to unbake the cake and find the sugar. It's not supply or demand, and it's all linked together. I hate to end it, but I got to get you back to seminar. Folks, thank you. I'm happy to...